This is Everything Elite, the world's best podcast devoted exclusively to All Elite Wrestling and the Elite Extended Universe. I'm Aaron Bentley, and I am joined, as always, by my good friend and co-host, Mike Spears. What's up, Mike?
Hey, y'all. It's your old pal, Iron Mike Spears. I'm doing good. I'm getting stoked for this weekend. You know, I mean, it's T-minus almost 30 hours, if that, 28 hours until the show. So I'm really excited about that, be up in Nate's neck of the woods. So yeah, I'm stoked.
Right. And of course, we're joined by Nate, aka Epitasis. What's up, Nate?
What's up, Aaron, Mike, everybody? Yeah, also getting stoked. It's I'm fired up, to quote a late friend of the show, Aaron Taub. looking forward to it. I always get like anxious right before big weekends because I have to do a shitload of work to sort of, you know, prepare myself for them. But you know, come 5 p.m. tomorrow, I'll be ready to go hard on the wrestling weekend.
All right. And as promised, we've got a special guest. We're joined by Adam, aka Wicca Phase Springs Eternal. What's up, Adam?
Hi. I didn't prepare anything cool to say, you know, the way Mike has his intro or anything like that. But I'm looking forward to this, and thank you guys again for having me.
All right. Thanks for being here. I intended to tweet like now or just before we got started to kind of tease that you were going to be on the show, and I forgot. So now the time has passed, I think. So we're going to talk to Adam a little more, and he's going to be with us for the preview. Before we get there, just make sure that you are following us on Twitter at EverythingAEW. You can find me at Aaron Like the Car. Nate is at Epitasis. Mike is at Fuji Heya. Make sure you subscribe to the show. There was a change in hosts this week, but it shouldn't have affected you. So, I mean, if you're listening to this now, it didn't affect you, obviously. So make sure you're either subscribed to the Everything Elite feed. You can search that on the podcast app of your choice, or the Voices of Wrestling podcast network. Rate and review the show, all that good stuff. And of course, we will read some funny reviews if you do them. So we're going to talk mostly about All Out, previewing the show, a little bit of notes on the TV ticket sales. And I think we're mostly going to skip BTE except for the important parts. But we're going to start with Adam. So if you don't know, Adam is Wicca Phase Springs Eternal. I'm not sure. I can't say you're in that because it's just you. But
right.
Tell us about that project and what it is.
It started as a way for me to make electronic music and just experiment with home recording and be a weirdo on the internet. And then so I was super active on Tumblr at the time that it started, like 2011, 2012. And through that met people who were doing similar stuff to what I was doing or doing stuff that I wanted to do, and somehow managed to make a career out of it. But I sang over rap beats, essentially. That's my that's it.
So, sounds a lot like what we do here.
Yeah,
be weirdos in our home recording setups, and definitely making a career out of it is what we're going for. So.
Well, it's like, so I was, so Suffer On is your newest album, came out this year, but it's much more, I guess people should also know that you were also in Tiger's Jaw, right?
Right.
People might be familiar with that band. I feel like Suffer On is more of like a return to kind of like more indie. You probably hate that sound or that name, but like an indie sound, as opposed to when I think about like Corinthiax is probably like the height of the stuff that I really like of yours. Just like that style. This is more of like, I think if you're into Tiger's Jaw, you could also be into the Suffer On record.
Yeah, that made sense. There was, I mean, I was doing, I was mostly working with other producers for years, just, you know, having them send me beats and I would sing over them. And then I signed with Run for Cover Records sometime last year. And sometime last year. And, was saving the project where I would, you know, produce the majority of it for something like that, where I had a budget and I knew there would be like a push behind it and, you know, a wider audience. And I think the result of that was Suffer On, which is mostly guitar driven stuff because I play a lot of guitar. And there was other producers. I worked with a producer named Doves who did most of the beats and the programming and stuff like that. And Will Yip, who I think we'll talk about later, but he, I recorded it in his studio and he did a lot there, but yeah, it does sound more like an indie album. And I think that's more in line with what Run for Cover puts out anyway. So it makes sense.
What are like the influences, or what are you drawing on for this kind of sound?
Early on, it was a mix between like 80s new wave, New Order specifically, or they were the big ones. But I also liked a lot of Crystal Castles, newer dance stuff, really. Crystal Castles, Salem. They're not like a dance band or anything. They're more heavy electronics. Witch House is what people call it. A lot of that, and like pop stuff, like 80s pop songs, honestly. And it evolved into more of a rap based project, but for Suffer On, it was me getting tired of any sort of new music and going back to listening to singer songwriter type stuff, Leonard Cohen, Nick Cave, stuff that like my uncles would have been listening to when I was a kid and trying to push on me, and just trying to make people take it a little bit more seriously than you might take SoundCloud rapper A, B, C, whatever, if that made sense.
Sure. You think that's more of the, you're going to stay in that lane, or is that like what you're, I don't know if you're working on new stuff, but is that kind of the lane you intend to be in?
I'm working on a ton of new stuff and it all sounds different. So I have no idea what, as far as studio albums go. Yeah. Sometimes I think I want to make like a club, like dance record with like just four on the floor, drum machines and stuff like that. Other times I think I want to just have a full band and, make it like a 70s Dylan record or something. So I have no idea. I have some time to decide. I have about 4 months or so before I have to start working on the next full length. And in between then, I have like folk stuff coming out. I have like punk stuff coming out. It's all over the place. So yeah, I guess I'll just see what works and what feels the most natural and go from there.
Where can people find your music?
I tell people Spotify. I feel like that's the most artist friendly way of listening to music. It's how I listen to music, but it's also where I see the most money. So do that. Yeah, Spotify. I mean, Apple Music, like any of those streaming platforms. I'm on SoundCloud too. Wicca Phase Springs Eternal is my name. Just, you can Google it, whatever you prefer, I guess, but it's everywhere.
Okay, I have to ask you about a specific song from Suffer On because of a friend of ours, Kara. I'm not sure if you have listened to the show when Kara has been on the show, but Kara is a furry. That's where that's the first thing you have to know.
Okay. I know.
And,
oh, sure.
And her fursona is cat based.
Okay. Right?
So yeah. You have a song on Suffer On that includes the line, and I'll botch this maybe, but I think it is, I like when she acts like a cat.
Yeah.
Well, I need you to tell us more about this line and about this song.
Cats are, they do what they want to do, and they will. I forget what song it is. Contact is the name of the song. Contact, track
Contact,
five.
Yep.
Yeah, track five. Contact, and I don't know. Cats are elusive, and when they're done with you, they're done with you, and they seem pretty honest. So I guess that's what that's about. Also, sometimes I write lines. I'll write a line that doesn't necessarily reflect how I feel, but it'll come to me, and then I'll know that it'll stick with people, and I feel like that's one of those lines. I can't say for certain because I don't remember anything about my music ever. So it's one of those two things. Yeah.
Well, it did the job. Also, that sounds a lot like Carl.
There you go. So.
All right. I won't put you on the spot about any more of your lyrics. That's okay. And I had to do that for Kara. Okay. Well, what we're going to talk about, of course, is mostly wrestling. So I guess your big connection to AEW is that you did Darby Allin's theme, right? Which you were nice enough to let us premiere it on this show. So you want to tell us about working with Darby and working on the theme?
Yeah, I met Darby. I think it was through Jimmy Havoc, actually. And the way that started, I'll try and make this quick. I'm friends with a musician named Cremation Lily, who was friends with Zack Sabre Jr. I had been I was at Evolve 99 and tweeted that I was there. And the next day, Zach saw the tweet and said something like Goth Boy Click or something. That's the group. I'm in a group called Goth Boy Click. And kind of blew my mind. And my friend told me that, like, yeah, he knows your music, blah, blah, blah. And Jimmy Havoc saw the name on Twitter and made his presence known in that tweet thread. So we did a collab t-shirt from that. And then I think Darby saw it or something like that. Around the same time, someone told me that Darby was into punk music and stuff, which, I mean, you could guess by looking at him, but it turned out we liked some of the same bands. Leftover Crack was the big one. So I just messaged him and I said, what's your favorite Leftover Crack song? And from there we started talking. He came to a few shows that I played, and I don't know that he wasn't like a fan of the music or anything, but Priscilla was a fan. He, you know, just mentioned that he needed a new theme for AEW. And I was, you know, more than happy to make it. I don't have a studio that I just record at home or anything, but he had sent me a few songs that he wanted it to sound like. Most of them were just like slow, like plodding punk songs, very obscure stuff, like stuff I never heard, stuff that was very hard to find on the internet. So I went to my friend Will's studio, Will Yip, and Will had done work with WWE before. He's if you watch Shinsuke's Titantron video or whatever they call it, he's the drummer in it, like after Shinsuke turned heel. He didn't play on the song, but Vince wanted like an Asian band, you know, because Vince is Vince. And Will is Asian, so he plays the drummer in that video. And he also worked on Bray Wyatt's new theme, too. But he's just, like, a wrestling fan. And so we recorded it, like, in a few hours. It was pretty easy. And first, Darby was... He wanted us to add... I think he wanted us to add some sort of slow piano intro. And I just didn't get back to him about that because I was trying to paint. And then he said, never mind. He was like, it's cool. And that was it.
All right.
What was the the experience of watching that debut at Fighter Fest like for you? Because that was like, you know, top three moments of the show, I thought, was Darby's entrance coming out with the body bag and with that song blasting.
Man, it was crazy. Like, I'm pretty critical of everything I do. So my first thought was like, we need to get him different versions of this song so it pops sooner, you know? So it's a pretty long song. And it doesn't really pick up until minute 2.5, which won't really make it to TV unless he's, like, getting some sort of, like, big, you know, title introduction or something like that. I mean, that was my first thought, but it was insane. And, like, the amount of people who, like, knew it was me, my timeline on Twitter was crazy. Like, I, you know, I didn't know what the crossover was like, and that was very cool. And I mean, I can't believe that he used it, honestly. That was my first reaction, was like, he said he would use it, but I can't believe they let him use it. And yeah, I mean, really wild. And I think during Fight for the Fallen, I'm sorry, Fight for the Fallen is when they they really got the levels right, like with the intros and the crowd reaction and stuff. So that's where you could really hear it, like clear and stuff. And it was, I don't know, it was like a dream that I never knew that I had. But once I saw it, I realized how cool it was and how I really did always want something like that to happen. And I can't believe it's Darby Allin.
Yeah, it's like basically the coolest guy in the promotion. So,
yeah.
I mean, I thought it was cool, and I'm just a fan of your music. I was like, oh, this is really cool.
Thank you.
You don't have to answer this. And if you say you didn't want to answer it, we will just cut this from the podcast. But I thought of this as you were saying that. Who owns the song? Or do you have a deal with AEW for this to be on TNT? Or
no. It's a pretty funny. Darby kept telling me that Cody personally was going to be in touch to send paperwork over, and he didn't. But I mean, we recorded the song for free. Like, I told Will, like, he was saying how excited he was to be a part of it, just because of how cool it was that AEW was going to be a booming promotion. And I gave Will this impassioned speech about how it's the least we can do for wrestlers, because, you know, wrestlers put their bodies on the line for our entertainment all the time and ask for nothing in return. So we owe this to wrestling culture, blah, blah, blah. And I feel that way. Like, no, they could have it. He said I could upload it to Spotify. It takes like a little bit of time for that to work. So it should be up soon.
Cody, I do have a minor in music business. If you want to, if you need a music supervisor on staff, if you need somebody to handle those music rights, and, you know, just got too many emails on your desk, hit me up.
All right. Well, we should talk wrestling at some point on this. So, I mean, I got from your last point, Adam, that you are a wrestling fan, and I know that you are. So what sort of wrestling do you follow? You're following AEW, I assume. What are you into?
Yeah. I watch, I used to watch so much. I used to watch a lot of Japanese indies and stuff like that. I really got back into it. I was into WCW as a kid, just because it was on earlier, then, you know, started an hour earlier. So I was really into that. And then I fell out of it, got back into it around like 2004 era Ring of Honor. Since then, stayed with it. Right now, I really only keep up with New Japan and AEW regularly. Evolve, I was all in on, no pun intended, honestly, right up until that last podcast ended, and for the same reasons that the podcast ended. We don't have to go into that. I try and keep up with any like big Japanese matches that don't take place in New Japan, whether it's like All Japan or DDT or Noah or anything like that. But as of now, like, anything that's under the WWE umbrella, including like Progress or WXW, stuff like that used to be really interesting to me. And now it just seems tainted to me in some way that I can't really explain. And I'm sure you guys know exactly what I mean, and people listening to this podcast might know what I mean, but you know, anyone challenging WWE is what I'm interested in watching.
Strong. I mean, I think that's why we're here.
Yeah, I agree.
Because we're all interested in that. All right. Well, I had one more thing, but we'll get to that as we go through, I'm sure, at some point. Let's talk about this card, and we will go down from the beginning and preview this bad boy a little bit. So, of course, we're going to get started with the buy-in, or we should say first that other than Adam, all of us are going to be there, right? Everybody's going to be it All Out.
Yes.
Yeah. I get into Chicago tomorrow morning, and it's going to be crazy, like 48 hours between all the stuff that's going on around Chicago and that. I mean, excited to see the Street Fight Boys and then go see the show and then get a chance to hopefully ask some of these wrestlers some questions backstage. So I'm really stoked for this weekend.
Yeah, I think Street Fight is sold out, right? But hopefully you have a ticket and you can join us. I think it's the Hideout. Is it the Hideout or the Hideaway?
I think it's the Hideout.
Yeah,
the Hideout. There's a place. Yeah. There's a place here called the Hideaway that I'm thinking of. So the Hideout in Chicago. Check that out. Murder Brian, Brett Payne, doing a show.
There are also Struggle
Session.
Sorry. There are also a bunch of other indie shows over the weekend, which you can check out. I've tweeted a bunch of cards if you're interested in any of those. I did want to shout out, some guy gave me his promo code to get 10% off Warrior Wrestling tickets. Nice. And that looks like a really good card. So that code is MOTEN, capital M-O-T-E-N. And you can see all the stars of CMLL and also Frank the Clown.
Nate's favorite wrestler.
He's good.
Or favorite, whatever he is. Okay, the buy-in. And, you know, I usually write the times here, and I didn't, but I think the buy-in starts at 6:30 Central Time?
Don't know.
Nope, nobody knows. Okay, that's okay. Casino Battle Royale is the first match, or I think it's going to be the first match. And this is all women, and it's to determine one of the participants in the first AEW women's title match. We've talked before that Britt Baker, Sadie Gibbs, Big Swole, Allie, Brandy, Nyla Rose, I got Britt Baker twice, Teal Piper, Eva Lise, and Jazz will be there. We found out this week that Awesome Kong and Shazza McKenzie are also going to be involved. We're kind of assuming that Bea Priestley is going to be involved, but no confirmation of that. And there will be a whole lot more. What, there's like 9 spots left, so who knows who else will be involved. But we know that it's going to be for a shot at the AEW women's title, so presumably it's going to be a pushed commodity going to come out of this thing. So, Nate, let's start with you. Who do you think is coming out of this thing as the winner?
I think they roll with Awesome Kong coming out of here. She has the kayfabe advantage because she is the awesome monster in the match. So if they're supposed to have an advantage in Battle Royales. Also, the winner of this is probably going on to wrestle one of the Joshi for the actual title. So it makes sense to have somebody who has some Joshi experience and can sort of cross over between those, you know, semi-divisions on that. So, you know, barring like a really giant surprise entrant, and I don't know that there are giant marquee surprises on the women's wrestling market, I'm going with her.
You know, it just seems like this is the position for Britt, especially after she had the unfortunate concussion at Fight for the Fallen, that it just makes sense that she would be someone that they have already pretty much focused the division around. She's been all over the first three shows. This will be the fourth. So it seems like that she would be the odds-on favorite with that. I am interested, though. I'm really stoked to see that Jazz is involved with this because she's someone that she wrestled a lot in my area when I was growing up, her and Ronnie Mack. So it's cool that she is a part of this, and then she's come back like doing the NWA stuff, and I thought that it's really interesting. So my head is saying Britt Baker, but my heart's saying Jazz.
That's fascinating. Yeah, I kind of think Britt Baker is going to be the first champion. I've just always thought that, and so I just expect she's going to win this and go on to face one of the Joshi. Adam, do you watch much women's wrestling?
No, not much. And this is the one I was most nervous about talking about, but it seems like I'm on the same page with everyone else. It seems like Britt Baker has just been the face of the women's division. And if she doesn't win this, I don't know if she has a path to being in that determining women's title match. So I'm going with Britt Baker, but I love the idea of Awesome Kong winning. So Nate might have convinced me that's happening. I'm not sure.
Yeah, Kong or Nyla Rose, I think, would also be cool options. I just think Britt's going to be the first champion. She's on all the posters.
Mm-hmm. She is. She's the only one that's been advertised for any future TV dates, I think, with the Britsburg date. She's the only woman that's been on any of those posters yet. So yeah. Distinct possibility, but we'll find out. I do really, the question here for this match, I think, is if they're going to like fix the presentation and formatting of how they do the whole Battle Royale, because, you know, had some hiccups with it being the first match ever on the first show. So, you know, want to see if they're going to get the entrances a little tighter and make sure everybody's getting their time to be like established as, hey, I'm entering the match and shit now. Also get a lot of surprises in this match, and surprises should be fun. Again, I don't know if there's like a giant marquee name out there, but, you know, are we going to see Penelope actually get to wrestle? Is Kylie Rae going to return? And I'm using a cheat to get around our rule on this podcast. Will we have April Mendez, the 21st entrant?
Excellent. All right, the other match on the buy-in, Private Party taking on Angelico and Jack Evans in a match that I can only assume is going to be an easy win for Private Party, but should have a lot of fun spots, right?
Yeah, I'm really excited about this, if only because Jack Evans has been always one of my favorite wrestlers. He was someone that I loved when he was in Dragon Gate, whenever he was in AAA, I like a lot. And then seeing him in the ring with the Private Party guys, I think it's going to be really kind of a cool moment because it's kind of two generations of high flyers, and especially indie flyers in there. And, you know, and Helico, when he does cool things, he does cool things. So I'm stoked about it. And I really hope this is a good opportunity to further get over Private Party, because I just love these guys. Like every time I've seen them, they've been excellent.
Yeah, this is really going to, I think, Private Party to the test, because this is like their first straight ahead tag match of the promotion. They were awesome in that three-way tag dance on the previous show, but they were kind of like protected in there to just get their big shine spots, and you know, weren't working a full match really. But like, remember in the All In pre-show when Kaz did that one like basic Northern Lights suplex spot and it just got like a gigantic pop? It was like the loudest pop you'd heard on a wrestling show in years. Like, if that's the level of expectations that the All Out crowd's going to have, then like this could have spots that just make them go ape shit. So I think it's going to be fun.
Adam, have you seen Private Party? Or yeah, you watched Fyter Fest, right?
I did. And so I'm a big Fyter Pro guy. And the way I have this weird logic in my head where I can't use a character that I've created or downloaded unless I watch a million other matches. So I've seen a good amount of Private Party, and I mean, I love them. I think they're great. I definitely think that they're winning this, as I'm sure everyone else in the world does. And I see Jack Evans and Helico as that veteran tag team that probably loses all of their matches, but just makes people excited about, you know, whatever they're doing. So it should be good.
I totally identify with that Fyter Pro thing, because I get like paralysis about it, where same thing as the old SmackDown versus Raw games, where I would download 50 wrestlers and like, okay, now I have to go through each one of these one by one and make sure they actually do all these moves and their attire is actually match reality. And then I just never actually play the game.
Yeah, I don't want to be a poser. That's my, but no one watches, no one knows like what I'm playing on Fyter Pro. But in my head, I don't want to be a poser, and so I have a list. I have a list on my phone right now of wrestlers I need to, you know, look up either on the High Spots Network or on YouTube or whatever, and familiarize myself with before I use them. I also have a list of. So as I'm doing this, I also write down their moves that they use, and I do it in the way that the Fyter Pro moveset thing is ordered. So I have like, you know, the basic strikes and then the grapples and then the ground moves and then the turnbuckle moves, blah, blah, blah. So if anyone wants that, I have like hundreds of them.
He's doing the work.
Yeah.
Do you think that you're just like fans of your music are going to listen to this podcast because you're on it?
Yeah, and they're going to be so confused.
That's what I'm wondering. How do you think they're going to react to your wrestling fandom, a deep wrestling fandom?
I think they're going to listen to a podcast I did last week where I talked about all the music that I'm working on, and then listen to this and realize why none of that is ever coming out.
Hey, I mean, I'm someone that if I'm on Fyter Pro or when I would play the WWE games, I would go judge everyone's edits, and especially Dragon Gate guys. And I would make sure that like, oh no, this doesn't look like Akira Tozawa whatsoever. Yeah. And I'd copy it, I'd remake it and post up it. And I would be the asshole who says much better than so-and-so the user title. Cause I'm that kind of dickhead. So I totally get this, Adam.
I just realized that when Adam was talking about all the big Japanese matches, he explicitly did not mention Dragon Gate. So
no, I do. No, I do watch some Dragon Gate. Usually when it's not bumped to the when it's not bumped from the Voices of Wrestling flagship, you know, and they end up talking about it, I get excited about Dragon Gate and stick with it for a month or two, and then it falls by the wayside. I'm sorry, Mike.
Oh no, I have like a personal battle with Joe Lanza and Rich Craich most weeks, where I mean, ABC's just in the Slack where there's been one match I've been trying to get everyone to watch the longest time just so they can talk about it. So I understand the importance of Dragon Gate staying within the third hour of the flagship. So mm-hmm. I've made my peace with that.
All right. And now we move on to the main show. And I assume this is going to be the opening match. This was the newest match that's been announced. SCU, Christopher Daniels, Frankie Kazarian, and Scorpio Sky. Took me a second there. Taking on Luchasaurus, Jungle Boy, and Marco Stunt. Who wants to talk about this one first?
I'll talk about it. I think it's smart that they've elevated the Luchasaurus and Jungle Boy team to this position where they're on the main card. They're opposite, like, very over people on this in this promotion. And they're obviously going to be featured strongly on this show. That's like, oh, wow, you know, this team got super hot out of nowhere. We're going to feature them more. That's cool. And I also think, like, I don't know that I super love Marco Stunt in the act because it seems like a complete act already, but it is sort of a good way to keep them busy and keep them in the spotlight while they're not into that tag team tournament yet. Like, they got eliminated from the pre-tournament tournament, so but they can still have this cool trios match. So, I mean, it's going to be fun because the Luchasaurus and Jungle Boy team has a bunch of spots that I hadn't seen before because I hadn't watched them before the Fight for the Fallen show. So you add in a second short guy to that team, I think there's probably going to be some novel stuff.
Yeah, this should be really cool. I like how SCU has kind of become the house trio that people are coming in with, like Strong Hearts at Double or Nothing, and now we're getting this again. And for a team like Jungle Boy, who every time I see Jungle Boy, I'm like, okay, this guy is going to be the biggest star in this industry if there's any like honor and luck in this universe. And I'm like, I watch him and I get more and more excited. And I'm just interested to see how over Luchasaurus is going to be after how he was kind of the biggest star in Jacksonville. So I'm just excited. Like, this will probably be the kickoff match on the main show. And I kind of like SCU in that role and them always having like a knockdown trios match to start. So I'm stoked for this. And I hope that, what was my nickname I gave them? I gave them some Joshi nickname. Oh yeah, the Neo Jungle Assault Nation. I hope they're the ones that get the win on this.
I have watched a lot of Jungle Boy over the past 3 weeks as part of my Fire Pro playing. And he does this, a really nice looking tiger driver. So I'm hoping we get to see that. Aside from that, I don't really have any other takes on this. It should be fun. And yeah, that's really it. SCU's awesome.
I gotta see Luchasaurus go over strong here. He was the surprise star at Fight for the Fallen. And I want to see him ride it out and see if they got something with this guy.
Yeah, I mean, I think his role is going to be as the tag team, at least until they really start giving Jungle Boy the big push, I think. But maybe it's Jungle Boy doing a splash off his shoulders to get the pin or something. Really a team effort.
All right, next on the card is Hikaru Shida taking on Riho. And as far as I know, only Dave Meltzer has reported that the winner of this is going to face the winner of the Casino Battle Royale. Have you guys seen anything officially from the promotion?
Nope.
Okay. I mean, it makes sense, right? Shida got the pinfall in the six-woman tag at Double or Nothing. Riho got the pinfall in the three-way with Yuka and Nyla. Of course, then she lost the fall at Fight for the Fallen, which irritated me. But they've kind of been the most pushed of the Joshi, at least. So it makes sense. I don't know. Like Nate mentioned last time, they've actually never had a singles match against each other, but they do know each other well. They've been on opposite side of tags, right? So hopefully they'll have good chemistry. It's just, I don't know what this match is going to look like.
Yeah, I mean, they're, veteran professionals. I'm sure they're going to do the necessary work to have a good match here. I think the question is sort of like, this is the first singles Joshi match in the promotion. And we know, like, the fans of promotion want everything to succeed and the crowd's like generally supportive, but it is like two relatively new people to this audience who are going to go out and have, like a 10 plus minute match probably. So, we hope that they can deliver in a way that gets the crowd behind them, cause that would be fun. It does make sense also that this would be to eliminate one of these people for title contention. Like, at least then there's some consistency with how they did it on the first show, and they had the singles match winner versus the battle royale winner. Like, it's still kind of stupid, I think, to decide your title challenger with that battle royale, but at least they're doing it consistently between the two top divisions.
Yeah, like, they're being consistent, and I'm with y'all about wondering how this will come across. I've started to really get into Riho since she's appeared. So like I've seeked out her stardom stuff. I saw her DDT or her Tokyo Joshi Pro thing from last weekend with Shoko Nakajima. And the more I watch her, the more I'm like, okay, I get everything about her and why they want her to be a star. And I feel the same about Hikaru Shida. It's kind of a shame that these two aren't the finalists for this, for the title, because I feel like that this could have been the stronger title match. So I think it'll be interesting. I'm stoked about it. Like, I feel like I'm saying that a lot. There is like one match in particular I'm not stoked about, but this is one that I am ready to see.
Riho has been the not knowing much about Joshi at all, Riho has been the one since the start of AEW that has leapt off the page for me, and I'd love to see her as champion. This is why I said earlier that I wasn't sure if I think it was that weird Meltzer post or whatever that said that the winner of this would also go to the finals, because otherwise I don't know if Britt Baker would be able to get in. But if that's the case, I'd love to see Riho in that match. I'd like to see Riho as the first champion, just because you know, I was walking into the Joshi women of AEW with a completely blank slate, and she was the most impressive in my eyes, and seems to be one of the more interesting women that they have on their roster. So I've decided to get behind her, and hopefully she wins this. Otherwise, I just need to watch more Stardom. That's what I've learned from listening to this podcast every week, and you guys do a great job of selling me on Stardom, so thank you for that.
That's great news. Very glad to hear that. And Riho was working heel on the most recent Tokyo Joshi Pro Show, so she can do that. I mean, obviously, Britt Baker is going to be a big baby face, so they could have the right dynamic in the match. I don't know. I get the sense Riho is going to win this, but Shida, if before this all got started and before Double or Nothing, it felt like Shida was getting was kind of going to be the push commodity, and then she went away for the two shows. So it might just be recency bias that's making me feel so confident that Riho is going to come out of this thing as the winner.
Yeah, I think Shida had the focus of her trios team at Double or Nothing. Like, she was the woman in the center and all that. But yeah, I'd like to see Riho win it. I am like Adam. She's been the standout of the women to me thus far. I followed that one Riho stand on our Twitter account, and now it's like our timeline's like 80% Riho standing. And I kind of enjoy it. I'm like, that's just some good, wholesome standing.
Yeah, she's easily stand. All right, a tag match. The winner gets the first round bye in the AEW Tag Team Tournament, which we've buried that step enough. The Dark Order take on the Best Friends. And I think the story of this match is going to be like, can the Dark Order finally get over with an AEW crowd that wants everything to be over and wants to respond to everything? But they haven't responded to this team. So I don't know. Do you think that they're going to be able to get a good response in Chicago?
No. I feel very strongly about this. No, I don't think so. I noticed on when this match was posted on AEW's Instagram, someone likened those minions that accompany them to the ring. Like
the creepers.
The creepers, yeah, they likened them to the Putty Patrol from Power Rangers and said that no one cares about them and no one cares about the Dark Order. And AEW responded and said that the Putty Patrol was a very important part of the Power Rangers franchise. and I thought that was super weird. And but it, and I do understand it. You know, you need to keep pushing something in order for it to get over in their heels. So, you know, they'll get some sort of heat just by being present. This is the Dark Order, not the minions. What are they called? I'm sorry.
The creepers, I think. Creepers. Is that official or did I make that up?
I don't know. I call them the minions or the spooky perverts, of course.
Right. I think spooky perverts might be the most official. I'm surprised that the Dark Order doesn't have that carryover love from PWG, even if it was like a few years ago. I was excited to see them. It doesn't seem like it's working. Hopefully they can get a dominant performance in here and, you know, give people no chance but to love them and want to see them work, whether it be as heels or whatever. But that Best Friends promo from Road to All Out, was it last week or 2 weeks ago, made me really want them to be the first champions. But there's no way they're winning this. It's Dark Order all the way, baby.
So yeah, I also was like very surprised, especially when they first got announced as coming to AEW or teased. Like they got the most positive reaction. Like everybody was, you know, over the moon that the Super Smash Brothers were getting their visa and coming to be an AEW. And then just, I guess it's all the new fans that AEW pulled from somewhere that don't have that familiarity with all their previous runs. But my take is actually to go off what was previously discussed. Remember how like the knife pervert line almost totally sank the Jay White character and like it almost killed his whole heel thing? I think the opposite's going to happen with the spooky perverts line, where the spooky perverts chant is going to be so over with the crowd, it's going to get everybody way into the matches. So like that's going to get the initial investment that you need, and then they're going to do all their crazy spots and moves, and it's going to get over. So I think Trent basically saved their careers with the spooky perverts line.
Yeah, and he started this spooky pervert line just in the backstage interview at Double or Nothing. Like it was just like an offhand thing that he was saying because he's just a weird person. And if he managed to get them over with this, then I guess he should get like a backstage writing job, just because if he makes this work for them, it does. But yeah, they need to do something big. They need to somehow tap into like the 2014 PWG vibe that they have, because they were so great back then and then they just disappeared. So I don't know. I mean, I expect them to win. This is the match I'm not really looking forward to, just because I can see it dying a death if the Dark Order doesn't get over.
Yeah, I expect Dark Order to win, and you can give the Best Friends the story of like having to overcome going through all the rounds of the tournament. Still expect them to be in the finals and maybe the first champions. I haven't thought that far yet, but certainly in the finals. You could redo this match. If the Dark Order gets over, you could redo this match in the finals, right? So, okay. Up next, I was going to call this the Wicca Phase special, but it actually has been sponsored. The Cracker Barrel Clash, folks. We got Joey Janela taking on Jimmy Havoc and taking on Darby Allin. I think the important part of this one, Adam, your role here is going to be to sell the rest of us on Jimmy Havoc.
It's pretty hard without having watched progress when he was their champion and just so hated in that company, and he's kind of been riding that wave since then. He's not a super worker, obviously. He'll take a ton of punishment. He'll bring the quote-unquote blood and guts. I know that he has to hate the name of this match, the Cracker Barrel, whatever. I know he has to hate that. I know Darby has to hate it. I can only imagine Joey Janela hasn't heard that that's the name of it yet or something like that. I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I don't think Jimmy is ever going to be a serious player in terms of like title contention or anything like that. There's definitely, I'd love to see him in big matches against Kenny or Moxley or Jericho or whatever, but I don't know. I don't think you need to worry about him. He's just a, you know, solid veteran hand, to borrow a Voices of Wrestling flagship-ism.
I do think this match maybe works to his strengths. Like, we think it's probably a plunder match, right? The Cracker Barrel aspect of it probably makes this a plunder match.
Yeah, someone's getting powerbombed on a barrel. For sure.
Yeah. So if these guys take some big fucking bumps onto a barrel and they have like a gimmicked barrel, or they have, you know, all sorts of nonsense, if they have like the Cracker Barrel games that they have at the table and they take bumps onto those, that'd be tremendous. And I don't even mind that it's like a three-way dance here, because it is probably a gimmick plunder match sort of deal. So you can have like, you know, one guy doing the Cage of Death Cracker Barrel construction, setting up tables and doing one thing, keeping busy while the other guys do the wrestling shit. Like, that'll work for me fine. So I think the Cracker Barrel thing is kind of funny to me. I don't know why. It's like the right level of irony for me, I guess. So this will be fun. The the gimmick and the build that they've done for it with the recurring Blink-182 appearances and references just enhances it all for me. So I think it's going to be fun.
Do you think they're going to have anything in the barrel?
No, it's going to be gimmicked so that it breaks easily.
Okay.
I see somebody
on the inside, right?
I see somebody doing the Sasuke spot.
Okay. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. I mean, I
probably
see Darby.
Yeah. Darby doing the Sasuke spot.
Yeah. I mean, especially since Sasuke couldn't get it right in the Janela match, Darby fixes everything, puts the barrel over his head, and yeah, takes some sort of nasty bump.
Yeah. I just hope it's going to be plunderful. Like, that's what I'm hoping out of this, and hopefully if the barrel.
Yeah.
I have some insight into the promos or the, you know, the packages that led up to this where they were fighting at the Blink 182 concert. Apparently that was legitimate. I don't think I'm blowing up anyone's spot by saying this, but they actually did go to a Blink 182 concert, those three and Tony Khan. And after they filmed it, they were in the crowd and I think Priscilla was there too, and they were annoyed that people weren't moshing or being as aggressive at a quote-unquote punk show as they should have been. So Jimmy and Priscilla started moshing or something like that, and people, this is what Darby told me, people took offense to what they thought was man-on-woman violence between Jimmy and Priscilla and started attacking Jimmy. And a legit brawl broke out between Darby, Jimmy, and Joey, and Priscilla, and some concert goers at that show. So they were vanquished to Tony Khan's private booth at the Blink 182 show.
That's a great anecdote. I'm very disappointed in all the Blink 182 fans for not being woke enough to appreciate intergender wrestling. Like, get with the time, guys.
We've gotten some really great lore on this show from Adam already. I guess most importantly on this match is, like, I just want to see Darby get over more than he did in the Cody match. I think that's not going to be a problem. And I just hope that Darby comes out like the biggest star of the match.
I thought he seemed like the biggest star. Real quick, I'm sorry. I thought he seemed like the biggest star on Fight for the Fallen. Like, I have a bias where, you know, I want him to succeed and everything, but I could not believe the reaction that he got in that opening match in the six-man tag. And when I talked to him about the coffin drop spot in his match against Cody, he said, "You haven't seen shit." So I'm assuming he's going to do something insane during this match as well.
Yeah, well, as you well know, this has, since its inception, been a very pro-Darby podcast, so we're all rooting for Darby. All right, the Escalera de la Muerte for the AAA World Tag Team Championships. The Young Bucks taking on the Lucha Brothers for approximately the 5,000th time. I don't care about this, guys. Is anyone excited about this match?
The real question of this match, I guess, is, like, is Phoenix alive and able to wrestle? And assuming that he is alive, will he survive to the end of it? Because he had like a semi-severe injury and then wrestled again the next night, but not really doing any wrestling or spots or anything. He's booked for AEW like tonight, I think. He might be wrestling twice between now and All Out because he's a fucking lunatic. I don't know how much money he needs to get from Tony Khan to stop taking 5 bookings a week, but Tony needs to pay him. Because Phoenix is just going to, you know, dive 6 feet into the crowd or 6 rows into the crowd every night until somebody, you know, gives him the money to stop.
Yeah.
Hawk texts me to let me know that he is a 10-minute walk away from AAW, but has instead decided to watch Cheers in his Airbnb.
I didn't know he was in town already.
Yes, he is. Well, he was, I don't know how much of TJ Hawk's spot I should blow up on this podcast, but he's like there on vacation. He's not going to All Out.
No, yeah, but he's going to Street Fight and then decided he's not going to the wrestling show.
That's a power move. Power move. Yeah, I love AAA. It is probably one of the promotions that I watch turn off my brain and not like have to cover. I just love basically everything about it. But this has been going on way too long, and that's me being generous. I just hope the Lucha Bros or Penta and whatever husk of Fenix is around are able to get the title belts, and then they just kind of do their own things. Like, you can do whatever in Mexico, but in AEW is good for TV. Let them do their own things. I'm done with this.
I'm so done with it. I have nothing more to add.
All right. I think that's a fair treatment of this match. Next up, Cody taking on Sean Spears in what's probably the best built match on the card. Certainly, I mean, not from like a in-ring scenario am I most excited about this, but it's probably, other than the Joshi match, it's probably the match I'm like most pumped for. Of like, I don't know. I just want to see how it plays out. They've worked me into getting excited about it. I don't know whether, like, Cody's best matches, and he's had some really good matches of late. If you take away the Dustin match, a lot of them are with much better workers that he can kind of use some shortcuts and figure out ways to make it exciting. I don't know if Sean Spears is capable of helping him do that and get to a really good place, but I'm willing to believe that it can happen.
Yeah, this will be interesting. I think we're good chance we get some plunder involved here too, because it's like a blood feud where they were, you know, once brothers, now enemies, and Sean Spears ripped his head open, etc. The atmosphere, of course, is going to be spectacular and is going to carry the match regardless of whatever work they do. Like, you know, we saw the Nick Aldis match, we saw the Dustin Rhodes match. Like, crowd's going to be way into this. They're going to hate Sean Spears. They're going to boo him out of the building. The build's been really good. I am a little annoyed that they haven't made more hay out of the fact that Sean Spears beat Darby at Fight for the Fallen, since this is like a Darby love-in podcast. Like, if you're going to beat Darby there, then you got to make it mean something and really hammer it home. But yeah, I think we get a whole bunch of overbooking with the 2 seconds. Everybody's going to have a manager in their corner, and we're going to get some like, you know, almost cheesy melodrama that makes it, just the right amount for Cody matches. So yeah, this is one of the top matches here. I think Sean Spears has to win, right? Like, you have to put Sean Spears over here.
Yeah, he's like dead in the water if he loses this match.
Y'all did a pretty good job about explaining my opinion about this match. I still think there might be an MJF turn here. So I'm going to hold out hope that this happens, just because MJF has been acting way too much like this for too long. So I can see MJF turning on him and then maybe forging a, like, I hate to say four horsemen like unit, but like just kind of having like a heel grouping between him and Sean Spears. So that's what I'm hoping comes out of this.
I think the four horsemen unit is coming, but you cannot do the MJF turn yet. As you yourself said, this is the preseason. We're in the preseason. So you have to get into the season and really establish the bromance between MJF and Cody before you do the big turn. Like, too early to pull the trigger on that yet, I think.
This is the type of wrestling that, as a kid, I hated. And it would always be like the, you know, there would be like on WCW, there would be the luchadors who I loved. And there would be like the superstars like Sting or Hogan and stuff who were like cool, objectively cool, presented as cool. And then there would be like the Southern worker types. And I could never get into that watching Ring of Honor early on, like people like BJ Whitmer or Ace Steel. I could never get into them. And somehow in 2019, it has been, it has become my favorite part of AEW. And now I kind of seek out wrestling like this. So I think they've done an awesome job in building it. They converted me. And I think this is my most anticipated match too. Sean Spears has to win. But yeah, definitely looking forward to this. Cody has had my favorite match on almost every show of this promotion so far, and I don't see this going any different. Like, they're both good workers. Sean Spears is a good worker. Like, there's no problem there. And yeah, they've built it so well that, you know, there's a lot of room for disappointment in this, but I don't see that happening at all. As far as the MJF turn, I can't really tell what's going on there, because we as fans know that it's coming, and we know that MJF, I guess he hates Cody. I'm not sure. I can't really tell, because he puts on for him when other people bash him, Cody, that is. And we know that his friendship with Cody is largely fake, as we've seen with his treatment of Pharaoh. But I can't tell. And part of me thinks that we might see an MJF face turn, where him and Cody do team for a little bit, and then the heel turn comes where he turns on Cody. But I can't figure out what's going on there. If you guys have any insight into that, let me know, because as a listener of the podcast, that is something that I've been wondering about for a while. So.
Well, I do think they do a team, but I sort of envision in my fantasy booking head is more of the Sting and Luger team, where you have like a guy who's, you know, a big face and like a figurehead of the promotion, and his like shitty friend who's like an asshole all the time, but they still get along and team together. I think that's the model for where you go with it. And I think to really elevate MJF to that next level and make him like a top guy in championship contention, you have to milk that for like, I don't know, 8 months of TV, a year of TV before you do the big turn.
Do you think it could happen during the tag tournament?
Could, but I think it's too early.
I think MJF legitimately loves Cody. I don't think that's fake. But I think
the character legitimately loves him, or the human being legitimately
the character.
Okay.
I think that's what we're talking about here, right?
Well, I mean, he keeps kayfabe all the time, so how can you distinguish?
You can't tell. But I do think MJF is drawn to Cody in like a real way. But that ultimately who he is as like just like a shitty person, his own self-interest will like overcome that love that he has for Cody. And that's what will make him be like, okay, actually it's in my own interest to turn on this guy ultimately. But I don't think it's fake. Like some of it is fake, obviously, the way he acts. But I think that he has a legit draw to Cody. And you see that in his reactions to like Sean Spears. I think it's real.
Yeah, that's what confused me. So I don't know. We'll see how it plays out.
We don't have an answer, unfortunately. Yeah. Real roller coaster.
That's the fun is the intrigue. We wait. Yes. And they tell us the answer.
That's right. Real roller coaster, Adam, with your talk there. I thought you were turning heel on All Southern Wrestling from like my childhood and the wrestling that I love the most. But it came around at the end, so I'm glad that we can still be.
I just didn't get it. And now I fully get it. And it makes me want to go back and watch old Terry Funk matches, which is not something I've ever done or anything like that. Yeah. And sorry to bring Ace Steel into the conversation, but continue.
Do we all still think that Arn Anderson is going to be Cody's second?
That's my pick, yeah.
I think so, too. I mean, it only makes sense.
It's MJF. Come on, guys.
I think it's Arn.
It's Arn. They're too smart to turn MJF. So at this stage in the game.
I'm a big Arn Barger, so I would really like to see. I mean, that would be cool for me to see him.
Maybe not. Picking MJF as a second is what starts the descent of their relationship. Ooh. We do a slow burn on it. And like, you know, we see the, I don't know what the model is, Batista and Triple H, where we just get little hints and hints and hints for weeks and weeks and weeks and weeks. Maybe that's what they do.
That's interesting. Okay. The next big match is, well, I can't even like do a cheesy way of being like John Moxley, but it's not John Moxley. It's Pac taking on Kenny Omega. John Moxley, if you don't know, is out, has a staph infection in his elbow. It's going to be out for 4 weeks, so he'll be back for the first week of TV, you would think. But they've come out with Pac as the replacement, which raises a lot of questions. I guess the big thing going into this has been let's talk about Moxley first, and then we'll talk about this match. So the big thing has been the Kenny promo on Being the Elite, where it's kind of it's a send-up of the Daniel Cormier and John Jones gimmick, where John Jones couldn't fight because he failed another drug test, and Cormier finds out allegedly like while he's cutting his promo. So they do that, and Kenny says, you know, he just wants to dim the lights and keep recording because, you know, he's going to shoot, of course. And basically this whole thing is like, okay, Mox, you thought you could be like me. You wanted to do the Kenny Omega thing and show that you were me, but you weren't good enough. You weren't as good as me. And, you know, you didn't win the G1 like I did. And basically you weren't a professional. You went to work 24 days out of the month before the big pay-per-view. and now you owe everyone an apology. I blame you for not being able to do this match. He says, I know I'm supposed to wish you a speedy recovery, but I don't give a shit if you ever come back. And like, so the most important thing to me about this is I'm more interested in this match than I've ever been, the Omega Moxley match. I think, I mean, it's kind of weird because Omega is positioned as a heel in that match, even though he's the babyface in this, what I think is coming up in this Jericho match that would be after this. But I don't know, kind of fascinating. What do you guys think about how that plays out? It's obviously a big bummer that Moxley's not going to be there. I was looking forward to seeing him live. But ultimately for the promotion, I think it's nice to have this match that you can save.
Yeah, this is a good program to save to first TVs and starting to build a big program there because it's got a lot of juice now. Like there was this Kenny promo, which the content of it I thought was really good. All the aspects where he took real world stuff and integrated it into the pro wrestling world is like exactly what you want from a pro wrestling promo. Like you said, the, you know, mocking his whole Warriors journey thing. And he like shouted out that the annoying Twitter meme of people doing like, you know, The Miz greater than sign Kenny Omega or whatever, you know, shitpost nonsense, like just like a funny thing to show that it, like kind of in tune with the discourse, I guess. But yeah, that's a great program to like put off. I don't know that he's really a heel. I think it's like, you know, one of these Cody Shades of Gray things where they're just like humans and they have different reactions to different circumstances and to different people. I think that's great if they have like consistent relationships like that going forward throughout the promotion. But yeah, like that match falls apart, which sucks, but we get like an actual dream match to replace it. Like former top champions of top global promotions wrestling in front of a big crowd, like for the first time, is pretty fucking sweet.
Yeah, this is wild, and I'll take my giant L.
Oh yeah, we forgot to make fun of Mike.
I was gonna hit it after.
Yeah, no. This promo is probably Kenny's best promo, I feel like, since I can remember, to be honest. I feel like he hit like all the good notes about it. I like how they kind of did the production stuff there. I thought that was a nice touch of them like going like, hey, do we wanna take five? And it's like, no, just bring the lights back up. Like, let's do this. I thought that was really great. And if anything, this makes this match more hot. We know they're probably going to have one more big show this year. And easily, if these two guys aren't around the title, this is where you would put it. Like, you put this match on this big show, you have this nice simmering feud. So I think that they've easily took a bad situation and now have made it one of the more hotter programs in the show because now they have no one expects Moxley to be there now. He did not show up to StarCast. There's going to be the thought in everyone's mind is Moxley going to show up after this match? So they're doing a great job, I feel like, of stoking the fire and being able to draw this out with that Kenny promo.
I thought it was a heel promo, and it confused the hell out of me on BTE, that is. And I thought Kenny was being positioned as like the babyface of the company. And now I'm not really sure what's going on. Like Nate said, it might have just been like a Shades of Gray thing where he legitimately does not like, or he doesn't like Moxley. He doesn't respect his decision to do the G1. But then he bragged about winning the G1. So I'm not really sure what's going on there. I feel like either way, I've been waiting for Kenny to have one of his like violent Kenny matches, like he had in New Japan, specifically the G1 match against Ibushi, where they were actually trying to murder each other and did it in a beautiful way. And I think we're still going to get that with Pac, if not more so. I don't know that like the build is there or, you know, the reason for him to try and kill himself in order to kill Pac is there, but definitely looking forward to this. And I think it might be a better match technically, in terms of like match quality or you know, technical whatever. So I'm definitely looking forward to it. Who's winning?
I think Kenny's winning. So my big question here was really like, what are these guys' directions coming out of this? Like, where are we going with both these guys who both are potentially really top guys? We know Kenny's direction somewhere in the near future is Moxley because they've been building that and they're continuing to build that. Pac is like, we don't know because I think Dave said he was originally on a 5-date deal when they were bringing him in, but that's obviously not like a long-term commitment there. Is he just doing the job here to be like, yeah, we had creative differences before and now he's willing to do business? Like, is that like a meta thing they're going to do? Meta thing? Did I fuck that up again?
Yes.
Fuck off. So I think Omega wins. You have to get him back to like the top pushed ace of the promotion level. And Pac, you can beat on like a meta level and be like, hey, you know, there's no more creative differences. As you can see, he's in here, he's in this promotion. And then come first TV, he should win all of his matches for the rest of the time.
I guess Pac taking a loss here, I think it would be natural for me to want to say, no, Pac doesn't take a loss here. Pac's like the most protective person of his gimmick. But at the same time, I don't feel like that Pac's story is with Kenny. You know, his story is with Paige. So if he is going to stick around, I can see the loss being on the stage here, like as Nate said, like showing willing to do good business, even though I don't ever really think that that was the case with Pac here. So it'll be interesting. And as Nate throws up a giant L on the webcam, yes, I was wrong. I was dead certain. There was a lot of people who I trust who tell me things about Dragon Gate that made me pretty much believe that Pac was never going to show up here because of reasons, and I'm wrong.
Well, we don't know that he's landed yet. Do we? Has he tweeted an airport arrival pic?
We don't.
He doesn't tweet. Yeah, we don't know that. And
is in Chicago, just so everybody knows.
Jericho?
Sheeta.
Oh.
She had a Starbucks.
Yes. Is there a chance? I know AEW says they don't do this, but is there a chance of a fuck finish here?
No. Because they canceled. Well, I guess if we think they didn't do the Paige match because of creative differences, then you can't not do a match because of a possible fuck finish there and then just turn around and do one here. Kenny wins clean in the middle with his move.
Well, I mean, because my thought, like my working theory is Omega is Jericho's first challenger and is the second champion. So he has to win this match for that to happen. So that's, but I could be, if I'm wrong about where we're going, then he doesn't necessarily have to win.
Do you think Jericho loses in his first defense to Omega?
No, I think he can have defenses before he loses to Omega, but I think that would be my next, that would be my match at the next big pay-per-view. I think they've talked about November. So he can do defenses on TV at some point and then lose to Omega at the November show. You don't sound impressed by that, Adam.
No. I'm with you on that.
My thought is, and I talked about this a little, I'll put a plug here. I don't think it's up yet, but I did part of the written preview on voiceofwrestling.com for this show. And my thought is, a lot of people think it's weird for Jericho to be the first champion because he's old and he's not been very good. He's had diminishing returns in his matches since his first New Japan match. But to me, it's really important for him to be the first champion. He's the biggest star that they have available to them. And most importantly, he can make the second champion. People are overestimating how popular Kenny Omega is. My thought is there are not 1 million. They need to get 1 million people to watch this TV show. I don't think there are 1 million Americans who know who Kenny Omega is. I don't think that many fans of his exist. So he needs Jericho to put him over. So that's what I would do to build my first real star.
That computes. I see what you're saying.
Yeah, no. I mean, that's something that I've kind of been arguing in private with people for a while. So, yeah.
I agree. You know it's real.
I don't know that I agree. It makes sense. It makes mathematical sense.
I should have just.
But I don't know if you go right back to that program. Because we know Kenny has to spend however long with Moxley first. So.
Well, you can do Omega Moxley after Omega becomes champion. You can let that simmer. The big match. The main event for the AEW World Championship, Hangman Adam Page takes on Chris Jericho. So there's two questions here. One, is there any chance Adam Page wins? Two, does anybody think this is going to be a good match?
Yes. I think they're really high on Adam Page. I think the Bucks and Cody and Chris Jericho are really high on Adam Page. If you go back to when Jericho first started in New Japan, that whole like, 6'6" does a shooting star press deep from the heart of Texas thing. That was a Jericho thing because Jericho was like super impressed with him. So I can totally buy that Jericho wants to make this guy on the big show, make him the first champion. He represents like new blood, new promotion. Cowboys are having a moment. There's a handful of reasons that Paige could win. Yes. I kind of am talking myself into Paige winning, because I, like Cody made a comment that was like, you know, we're not running this promotion to appeal to casuals or to appeal to lapsed fans or to steal from WWE fans. Like, we're doing this to appeal to the fans that brought us to the dance and the people that have been following us and what they like in their wrestling or whatever. And I said it before, but Hangman is the first star that was made on BTE, and this is a promotion that came out of BTE. So I think I might do it. If he rides a horse to the ring, it's a lock. The other question is he ready to follow Kenny Omega versus Pac with a 48-year-old Chris Jericho?
Yeah, that's going to be the big question for me. I just, like, Jericho's someone that I like him a lot. I mean, he was my favorite wrestler growing up as a kid, and I've liked how he's evolved, but this is a pretty big task for Jericho to have a match like this. You know, this is their last big show before TV. It's been promoted on TNT, and it's going to be a big effort there because Hangman, I mean, he's someone who got over initially through like comedy stuff, like on BTE. Like, he was like that was how he got over initially. And now they've made him like the serious challenger, and it just rings kind of false. And to what Aaron said about, like, is there any chance that I think that Paige can win the title? Yeah, there's a chance, but it's the wrong decision for right now, and especially wrong with how they've booked everything. So
I think Mike is right. And they seem to be bringing it up on Being the Elite and Road to All Out, where he's constantly challenging the naysayers and addressing them and, you know, voicing all of the same concerns that we're voicing here. And it's still not convincing me that he would be a smart pick as the first champion. Anytime I tell someone about AEW, their first question is, who's in it? And my first answer is Chris Jericho. And yeah, sometimes people say, like, how old is he? But most of the time people are very interested, and that is enough to make it seem like a legitimate promotion to them. So I think going into week one TV with a heel, Chris Jericho, and he's been a great heel, you know, since AEW started. Him as champion seems like the smart move, and I love Hangman. I want him to be the face of the company eventually. I just don't know that if it's there yet, and I don't want the company to take any unnecessary risks at the moment. With, you know, so much at stake, I gotta go with Jericho, but I do think that a part of me thinks that, you know, the Elite boys, Cody and the Bucks and Kenny might give it to Paige for the reasons that, you know, Nate said Cody brought up.
Yeah, I think, so I agree with everyone in that. I think the smart move is for Jericho to win. I will, sitting in the building, I will be putting aside that I want this company to succeed at the highest level, and I will be rooting for Adam Page to win because that's like the most fun result.
I do wonder if you do the most logical thing and have Jericho win. I mean, it's not like a WrestleMania kind of thing, but it is like you're ending your big show. It's like your anniversary show now. It's your last big show before TV with a big heel becoming a champion. They had Jericho win on Double or Nothing, but then gave everybody the giant moment with Moxley coming out. I don't think they have, well, I guess you could have Mr. April Mendez come out. But
I was going to say, yeah, Redacted could come out.
I just, is that how you send everybody home and ready for TV come October? Is like, you know, the guy who we all hate, it has the belt, or does that not really count because we all like secretly, you know, love and appreciate him?
I think I thought of that earlier today, Nate. I think you're exactly right that that's kind of a sour way to end the show, especially because I really expect the crowd there to get behind Adam Page. So you almost expect that somebody has to come out afterward. But Are you running the risk then of being the promotion where your big shows end with a guy coming out after the main event and that's how you end all your shows? I mean, it's a little, they've already done it.
Yeah, but it is awesome. So
yeah,
it's like a very good problem to have. It's like, oh, we keep having huge surprises.
Right.
Sure. Sure. I mean, I guess you brought it up, so we should have to say it. Everyone should have to answer. From, you know, give us a percent.
Oh, me? I'd say about 25%.
Wait, what are you answering? I didn't ask the question yet.
Oh, I thought you were talking about CM Punk.
Why did I say the name?
is CM Punk going to show up on this show? Percentage. Mike goes 25%.
Yeah.
31%. Is this Price is Right rules, or how do we?
Yeah, closest without going over.
10%. And if that happens, CM Punk is your next champion, and it'll happen at Jericho's first defense on TV.
That would be a hell of a way to get this thing started. Yeah, I'll go with 24%. I'll go right under Mike.
I'm the high man. Okay.
Real dick move.
I really don't see it happening, but it does make sense. Like, a lot of it comes together.
Yeah.
Where you can see it making a lot of sense. It would be a wild way to end the show. I mean, the place would go nuts. Is there any doubt about that?
No, I mean, they would lose their shit.
No, they have to buy Cult of Personality. They have to play that. Otherwise, it's a waste.
Yep. No argument. All the like haters would like immediately get swept up in the moment too and be like, oh, you know, we hate him, but this is awesome. Everybody's losing their mind. I think we've given that enough time.
Okay. All right. Before we get done with All Out, I just want to go around. We'll start with you, Nate. Your most anticipated match on the show.
I guess it's Pac versus Omega. I don't like, none of the individual matches are super alluring to me. It's not like there's a one thing on here that I'm dying to see the action of. Really, the event and the atmosphere and that whole experience and hanging out with my friends is the big draw. But Pac vs. Omega, I hope, really reaches the level of like a top tier Omega New Japan match that, you know, basically birthed this promotion because he became an international star. And don't know if I've seen a match on that level before in my life. So,
Mike?
So, after going to Double or Nothing and being in the crowd there, the person that I really want to watch live again, just because of it was the first time I felt how he was always positioned, is Cody. Because Cody was always someone that I felt like in New Japan and Ring of Honor, that he was always positioned as this person that he never really was. And when at Double or Nothing, he came out, he did the whole Throne Breaker thing. And just like, it was the legit goosebumps moment. It was like, okay, he is like this force that he wants to be. And he followed up with one of probably my third favorite match I saw live this year behind Momo and Utami and Naito Ibushi. So like, it was an incredible match. So I'm excited to see what could happen here with Cody and Shawn Spears. I didn't think I would say that. Like, I was looking at this, you'd think I would say Pac Omega, but no, I really want to see how Cody is live again, because it was kind of a transformative experience seeing him live in Vegas. And I'm wondering if he could follow up again on a big stage.
Adam, what do you got? What are you most looking forward to?
I'm with Mike. It's Cody versus Spears. I bet against Cody every time for every AEW show. And he's proven me wrong every time. So I can't do that again.
I'm going to stay on brand. I'm most excited for Shida versus Riho. I am who I am, as I've said before on this show. I've seen Darby Allin in front of like very few people. And so I'm very excited. Like the first time I saw Darby Allin live was the ladder match with Ethan Page in Orlando Mania weekend. And so this will be really cool to get to see him in front of this big, huge crowd. So I'm happy for him. I'm excited about that.
I do. On that point, I'm hoping to match what friend of the show Drew Spears did on Double or Nothing. You can hear Drew Spears doing his patented screaming of Jack when Jack Evans comes out. You can hear that on past Bola DVDs as well. He just screams. I can't even do it because he just screams Jack with such force. So I have been trying to make that my thing with Darby, like at AEW shows. So I'm in the 100 section, and I'm going to try and get my voice on the broadcast screaming Darby. I am sitting next to my normal friend who will probably look at me very funny. But these are the prices you pay to be a you know, top tier pro wrestling podcaster. So,
well, you and I saw Darby take on Matt Riddle at Evolve in Chicago and yelled for Darby so much that it disrupted Matt Riddle and he like talked to us during the match.
Don't boo me. Fuck you, Matt.
Great match. Okay, let's get into some quick news. So TV, let's talk about that. Sorry, Adam, I hope you know that these shows go a while.
yeah, I'm prepared.
Okay. All right, so this is a note. August 30, so Friday, I've lost track of days, 10 p.m., countdown to All Out on TNT. So I don't know what that's going to be, but a little preview show for All Out. So check that out.
I guess that's our road to replacement for this week because we didn't get anything.
That's right. We will be at Street Fight, I think, when this airs, but I'm sure I'll see it at some point. So Pittsburgh and Charleston TV went on sale this past week. They did not sell out, certainly not instantly. I noticed that they've removed the maps on Ticketmaster, so you can't actually tell how many tickets are left. From my look, and this was yesterday, you can still get $75 tickets in Pittsburgh, and you can still get $45 tickets in Charleston. Dave reported that they sold 4,000 tickets for the Pittsburgh show and 3,000 for the Charleston show. So kind of disappointing, I would say. But according to Dave, it's going to be in line with what WWE shows are doing or have done, especially in Pittsburgh. So maybe it's what you should expect. And they kind of built expectations a little too high with selling everything out within like 10 minutes.
Yeah, I guess this the jury's still out on how successful the promotion will be here. We were like really riding a high on their previous sellouts. And I said, if that Charleston date does super well, they're going to kill it on TV as well. So, I guess the Charleston date looks like it did fine to this point. We don't know how they're going to do head to head with NXT. I was surprised the flagship guys both came down pretty strongly on saying that NXT is going to beat them head to head. So it's going to be fascinating to see that develop.
Adam, we've never heard any of your thoughts about AEW's TV and the ticket sales. Does any of that interest you or even them going up against NXT? What do you think about that?
As far as ticket sales go, it's a relief that we finally broke in the instant sellout barrier as like a performer who gets ticket updates to their shows. It's like the most nerve-wracking thing in the world. And sometimes it's a relief to have a show that does bomb. Just not that these are bombs, but, you know, have a show that doesn't sell out instantly. Just so, you know, not that you have a night off, but you can, you know, you have to work the crowd extra hard or something. And you know that, you know, people aren't just there because it's a hard ticket to get or something like that. As far as NXT goes, I'm bummed about it. I don't know if you guys said it, but it makes, even though I don't think this, and I know that none of you guys think this probably, it does make NXT seem minor, or AEW seem minor league, because NXT is a minor league of the WWE, essentially. Kind of a slap in the face there. As far as NXT announcing sellouts, which are, I think Aaron Taub posted were like 400 tickets or something like that. Or I don't know if it was 400 total between two shows or 400 for each show. I thought that was kind of a slap in the face too, and kind of a reach for WWE to be promoting that as any sort of success. They should have no problem selling out 200 or 400 cap arenas for anything they do. It's a bummer to think that some people might choose Johnny Gargano over Kenny Omega any day of the week. I'm not happy about it, and I'm almost taking it personally.
I can sense that.
Yeah, it really does bum me out. it's not the same thing at all. It makes me wish that they did just retrench that it, that, you know, if he had the decision, they would have went head to head on Monday nights. And as soon as they announced the NXT thing, I thought the same thing. I wish they did that too. I'm sure they'll pull WWE will, you know, do everything in their power that third week of NXT when they're head to head with AEW for the first time, to get people to watch their show, whether that's, you know, putting Roman Reigns against Tommaso Ciampa or something like that. Nah, it bums me out. At the same time, I'll probably be flipping over to NXT on commercial breaks to see what they're up to. Especially if the rumors of Enzo and Cass being brought back for that are true. I should mention that I went to the NEW show last week. It was here in Scranton, Pennsylvania, and it's rare that we have any sort of wrestling. So an NEW show might as well be like SummerSlam coming to Scranton. And there was a rain out or lengthy rain delay after the third match, and Enzo and Cass read Greenades and Ham to buy time for the show. So and at no point during that did I think, man, are these people that I'd watch on Wednesday nights over AEW.
So it does sound like you're pretty firmly in AEW's corner on that matchup. And I've been trying to push this narrative on the show of basically everybody in a creative field or that works in any sort of arts capacity, like, immediately jumped to being an AEW fan as soon as it was, you know, announced and debuted and everything. Do you have a take on that, or have you observed that in your own dealings in the creative industries?
I've noticed that anyone I talk to about AEW who knows what it is a creative person, whether they're in a band or something like that. If I'm like meeting someone for the first time at a show and they want to talk about wrestling, it's usually AEW. So yeah, I'm with you on that. I think that's a good observation on your part. It rings true with my experience for sure.
There you go. AEW is the cool promotion.
Yeah.
Take it down. Cool. Yeah.
All right. Here's some Mike Spears territory news. November 6th. You know, I was thinking as I was writing this in the notes, I was like, okay, at some point we're going to stop reporting on like where they're going to do TV every week. Like at some point, no one will give a shit. That's not yet. November 6th, Charlotte, North Carolina at the Bojangles Coliseum, folks.
Yeah, this is my culture right here. You know,
this is
whenever anyone comes like through the Carolinas or down to Georgia, Bojangles is kind of the place. Like I know Popeyes has gotten kind of the pub lately for their sandwich, but Bojangles is the thing in the area. And it's a cool arena. It's a super old arena. It's like from the 50s. I went to a hockey game there once when I was an undergrad, but it's interesting because it is clearly like the C arena in Charlotte. It's not the Spectrum Center where the Hornets play. It's not like any like the minor league baseball parks or the college stadiums. It's like this kind of old place that Jim Crockett used to run that was like a WCW spot. So it's cool that they're doing this. And you know, if Cody's doing this for like booking here, I'm wondering what he's going to try to do in like the Greensboro area. Like that's what immediately came to my mind here. So I think it's rad. I'm glad that they are going to Bojangles. It is like the better chicken option. So, and and they have like they have the Cajun filet biscuit. AB, I know you're a vegetarian, but it's like one of those things. And as like a rite of passage is like when you're going to places or going on vacation, you go stop by and you get a bag of chicken filet biscuits. So I dig it.
I had a friend or not really a friend, but an acquaintance from like work that I do say to me the other day, wait, you're a meatless person, aren't you? Is that the terminology?
New one to me.
Is that like the woke way of saying vegetarian now? Very strange to me.
I'm a vegetarian and I've never heard that. So
yeah, I've never heard it either. No idea. Okay.
I feel like it's less woke and probably more insulting was probably the intent.
Oh no, this is a very sweet guy.
Okay.
Yeah. He's like an I think he's like an archivist, so I think he and Mike would get along probably.
Oh hell yeah.
Yes. Okay, so they're gonna apparently set it up for 7,000. Folks, it's time to shrink these. shrink these seat setups. Interesting, I guess, that WWE is running a pay-per-view 9 days after this in Charlotte, but it's going to be at the Spectrum Center. So both the tickets will be on sale at the same time. So we'll see how that goes.
Do you know what one they're naming this pay-per-view?
I could not have any idea.
Clash of the Champions.
Oh! Very...
That's ice cold.
It's a direct shot at Cody, really.
It is.
It's like the one thing he wasn't able to buy the trademark of when he went on that trademark spree of getting like Bash at the Beach and all the things like that. He did not get Clash of the Champions. So,
and Mike tells me it was announced at the All Out press conference tonight that AEW's TV on November 27 will be at the Sears Center in Hoffman Estates, where All Out is going to be. And tickets are going on sale tomorrow?
Fuck, I got text to send.
Yeah, no, this was, I was scrolling through Twitter because they were doing the press conferences just to see if there was anything going on. Like, there was, like, what you would expect. Apparently, Marco Stunt weighed in at 102 pounds at the weigh-in. So, good for him. But, yeah, no, this is going on sale here, and that kind of gives you a little break between the November 6th and the 27th. So, but, yeah, going on sale. It'll be interesting to see if they would be able to get three straight sellouts in Chicago.
Interesting strategy to put tickets on sale before All Out. Okay, a couple of news notes, and we'll be out of here. We found out Kenny Omega is going to return to DDT on November 3. It's going to be, apparently Omega chose the match, and it's going to be Omega and Riho versus Antonio Honda and Miyu Yamashita. You know, I say that name all the time, and I just said it wrong. It's Yamashita. So a lot of speculation straight from Takagi, the DDT owner, that this is a tryout of sorts for Miyu, and that this is kind of Omega wanting to see more of her to see if he wants to book her in AEW.
Is that a thing? Are tryout matches a thing where people have to like wrestle with somebody to see if they want to? This reminds me of like when the WWE fans were like, "Oh, Chris Jericho is just going to New Japan because he's going to try out Kenny Omega to see if he's ready for WWE." Like that idea just sounds like a little like I'm pretty sure Kenny Omega's watched enough wrestling that he can like watch Miyu and determine that she's a good wrestler, right?
I will say that there are tryout matches in Dragon Gate for foreign talent.
But they wouldn't wrestle like Shima or the Booker, right? Like you could have a tryout match and like sit there and watch them and determine if they're good.
Yeah.
I would guess.
Yeah, but it's like if you're going to go wrestle foreign talent, usually you go do a tour and you see how things are going. I remember that, who was it? Giselle Shaw pretty much was brought over to DDT because of how great her match was with Mayu Yamashita. I think it was Will Ospreay's promotion. I was blanking on that for a second.
Frontline.
Mm. Yeah. So, I mean, like, it happens, but it's, I kind of take a lot of things that Takagi says as just a work. So,
oh, yeah. I think this is a work. I think Miyu will come over and this, like, after the match, Kenny will, like, shake hands with her and bow to her and be
give her an American flag off of his tights.
Yes. Like, I was so impressed with her and now I'm going to bring her over. So, anyway, the crowd went nuts when this was announced at the DDT show. It's going to be over huge there. It's cool to see Kenny going back to Japan and back to DDT.
Really going to be interesting for his Hall of Fame case to see what kind of boost he gives to DDT, especially if he's like at all regularly or occasionally appearing there. Like, because I think they've been on a downswing. I don't know if people get mad at me for saying that, but like, going to see if he gets a shot in the arm to get like, you know, back on the level of a Dragon Gate.
I'll say it. They've been on an absolute downswing if you look at their business, especially at Cork and Hall, and they don't draw very well outside of Tokyo. I'm willing to take that fire. So, yeah, it'll be interesting for him.
Well, they're about to run Sumo Hall, and they have booked 82 people.
Yeah, they booked that. Amazing. And then the next year, even more so, they're doing a show at the Saitama Super Arena, like where
SSA, I know it well.
That's a big arena for like, well, you know, because of all the idol groups and K-pop, but like that was always the place for pride in them they always would run that if they weren't running the domes, and they ran it before and they did not go so well. It's like 22,000. So if Kenny comes back and does like a huge like boost in the arm, then that could be something really incredible for him. So
Adam, are you into K-pop at all?
No, not really. But there's a video of...
I almost asked.
No, but there's a video of... Oh, I just forgot their name. But whoever sings the Gundam Wing theme song or opening song. I think it's called Rhythm Emotion or something like that. There's a video of like a live performance of whoever sends that. It's like a 5-person group that I send to my group chats all the time and tell them that we need to get on the same level of synchronization that they're on. So no, but the short answer is no.
Okay, I mean, just had to check.
Lisette, could it be Lisette?
No, it starts with the.
It looks like that's probably.
It has the number 2 in it.
Two mix.
That's it.
I'm not familiar.
Oh, it's so inspiring.
Oh, this goes way back. This goes back to 95.
It's
okay.
So inspiring. I think there's.
I'm not a giant robots guy personally.
I am a giant robots guy. So.
I can. I'll recommend. There is a series of anime idols piloting giant robots. Actually, there's multiple of these, but one in particular, the Idolmaster Xenoglossy is all about the beloved Idolmaster idols piloting giant robots in a battle for the fate of humanity.
Okay, you'll have to have me back on the podcast so we can talk about that.
This is good. We didn't get any 5-star reviews, so that'll be our show closing banter for when you come back. Is okay. The Idolmaster Xenoglossy.
I just love the bigness of K-pop, like how, what's the word I'm looking for? It's like, it reminds me of like No Limit, you know, like in the 90s. It's just, everything is so big and the videos are insane and the stage shows are insane. And I love that, live for it.
Oh yeah. Like the thing I've been watching nonstop, I post about Twitter, is someone who was on Idolmaster is now doing like K-pop version of City Pop, which is something that I've recently got into. And they did like this really well done, like 1980s Japanese style video for a K-pop song. And it was awesome. Like, I love the video production. I love watching the videos, even though it's not necessarily like my favorite kind of music, but you like see like what they do and you see like all the production and just how like the lighting and the coloring, it's incredible.
That's friend of the show, Yukika.
That's right. I watched that when you posted it.
Good tip.
That I'll watch. The Dragon Gate matches you recommend. But Yukika.
Yukika rules, and also UT versus Super Shisa rules. I'm just going to leave it there because I didn't talk about it on Open Voice Gate. Yeah, that match rules.
All right, last news note. Tony Schiavone signed a full-time multi-year agreement. I love that language, even though it also says he'll still work with University of Georgia football and baseball and the Gwinnett Stripers. So
and MLW.
Yeah, so I don't know how full-time that's going to be. The press release made it sound like he'd be on commentary, but Dave reports that he's going to be doing backstage stuff with Alex Marvez, and the main broadcast team is going to be Jim Ross, Golden Boy, a.k.a. Alex Mendez, and Excalibur.
That's got to hurt for Alex Marvez to have a guy with such a similar name take his spot.
Brutal. Yeah. Were you a Tony Schiavone fan as a WCW fan, Adam?
Yeah, and whenever people bash WCW, one of my gut reactions is, but Tony Schiavone was awesome, right? So I'm very excited to see him back. I mean, even when I hear him in MLW, I think he's great. So yeah, I'm all for that. It doesn't really help disassociate AEW with WCW at all. I don't know if that's something that they're actively trying to do, but you think of a major number 2 competitor to WWE, and you think WCW, and I don't know if having one of the voices of WCW helps with that, but who cares? Like, he'll be good.
Yeah, I feel like their ethos is kind of who cares. Like, I just feel like they're not scared to make decisions based on that sort of train of thought, you know what I mean? Like, I totally get the same thing. Like, it is kind of like, oh, you guys are really like running WCW towns and you've got the WCW sort of vibe, and they're just like, yeah, they're just going to do what they're going to do, and they think it's good, and WCW is always bad.
And honestly, there are some great early WCW shows with Jim Ross on commentary and Tony Schiavone backstage, so I don't know if Jim Ross is not quite on that level anymore, but still kind of cool. In Greensboro, actually, now that I think about it. Okay, so that's pretty much all for this episode. I think the one thing we didn't talk about, Adam, so I'll close out with this. People probably think it's pretty weird, like the fact that you are on this podcast at all. Why do we know each other? Very strange. So I guess everybody should know that, and I learned some of this. I mean, I knew this because you DM'd us before, but, you know, I listened to your turn on the Turned Out a Punk podcast with Damian Abraham, which was very cool. And I understand that you were a listener, but how in the world did you find the Everything Evolves podcast?
It was definitely through subscribing. This sounds like a plug. I'm sorry, but it was through subscribing to the Voices of Wrestling podcast feed on like whatever the podcast app is on Apple, whatever. And I was watching Evolve heavily at the time, so I think I was like day one, right into the Everything Evolves podcast. And yeah, it was through that. And I have to thank you guys for helping make that Turned Out a Punk episode happen, because someone else had messaged him. I think someone else who he plays in a band, Damien plays in a band with, had messaged him and told him that I was interested in doing an episode. But I got that episode because he had heard my name previously through the Everything Evolves podcast. So thank you for that. I'm not sure if that's what you were looking for, but no, it was, yeah, it was through the Voices of Wrestling podcasting network.
Wow. Well, I did not intend for that to be a plug. I mean, I wanted to plug the fact that very cool people listen to every iteration of this podcast. That's all I wanted to get out. I didn't know about you about your music until you DM'd us because Aaron was going to be at an Evolve show you were going to be at. And so you guys met up and I was like, okay, I got to learn more about this dude. And yeah, became a fan. So, I mean, I knew about Tiger's Jaw, but I just didn't know that what you were doing now. So that sounded rude. I didn't mean
no. It's okay. I have I will plug that I have a new band. So when I left Tiger's Jaw, two other people left it too. And that was like 6 years ago. But the three of us started a new band called Pay for Pain, which is not nearly as heavy of a band as the name suggests. But we just started playing shows and stuff. We'll have music out hopefully by the end of the year. So if you like Tiger's Jaw, listen to that.
Very cool. My wife yells at me for constantly loudly and off key singing Planes versus Trains. I just like break that out occasionally and she'd never heard it. And I made her actually listen to it one day because she's so annoyed by that. It's just usually stuck in my head. So
yeah, that's not one of my songs. So when people say that, I don't sing that one, but Ben and I have similar voices. So when people bring that up, normally I let it go, but I feel that we've developed a good rapport where I could break that to you and not.
Mr. Matt, I had to call out Aaron earlier today for just the mortifying text that he sent. So this is good that everybody's, you know, we're on a level with you, Aaron, where we feel comfortable being honest with you and just telling you you're fucking up big time, man.
I just got outed on my own podcast as a fake geek fan.
I'm leaving the set.
Fucked up. This is so fucked up. Cut all this.
Do better.
This is all got to go.
Oh, no, do better.
Okay. Well, I'm not going to say anything else nice about Adam or his music projects.
Please don't.
Probably ever again. But thanks for coming on the podcast anyway.
We might need to trade Aaron's for the next episode. I don't know.
Yes. You all have betrayed Aaron. That's for sure.
Betrayed yourself.
If you all still want to listen after hearing this betrayal, then make sure you subscribe to the show, Everything Elite, or as my once friend Adam did on the Voice of Wrestling Podcast Network. You can follow us on Twitter at Everything AEW. I'm at Aaron Like the Car. Nate is at Epitasis. Mike is at Fuji Heya. And Adam is at Wicca Phase. So follow him there, unless, again, you're loyal to me. In which case, block and report his ass.
Can't recommend it. It's more heat than it's worth, guys.
That's true.
Thank you for having me again. I feel like I should make sure people hear me thank you one more time before we end this, because I really did have a good time, and I hope I didn't mess up the flow of how it normally goes. You guys have good chemistry with each other, and I was happy to be a part of it. So thank you.
Oh, thank you. It was really fun.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, thanks for coming on. We really appreciate it. And I guess, against my better judgment, I will continue being a fan.
Thank you.
All right, check out Wicca Phase on Spotify, apparently. Make sure he gets paid. And we'll look forward to hearing your song at All Out this weekend. So for Mike, for Nate, for Adam, I'm Aaron. We'll see you next time.